like that. My man Tony. Tony Tito Washington. Talk about building a brand online, right? Golly. Using his unique talents, right? His particular niche, all the different things that Sean Haynes was talking about in that wonderful session that he just had. Have us lunch. Good. I just saw, as Tony was singing up here, I had the door open in the back so people could hear, so that, you know, you guys knew that it was time to come in. And so I had the door open, and I watched a lot of people pointing as they were walking by to their conference down the hall, and they were like, bunch of them, man, because we do things a little differently up in here, don't we? Speaking of people who do things a little bit differently, there's a young lady who is a phenomenal human being. I am so thankful that her and I have connected. She has been in the automotive space for her whole life. Her family has made a massive impact in the auto industry, all the way up to her father. Is that your dad? That's her dad. That I met. He's phenomenal. And so she has made a massive impact in the industry doing something completely different, something that I've never seen before. Every single employee in her dealership is an owner, right? Now, I've worked in dealerships where I tell people to take ownership, but I don't actually give it to them. She actually gives her employees her ownership in the company, and the results that she gets from doing that is absolutely phenomenal. Her and her general managers and her employees, just all of them, it's incredible. You've heard about them before. So I'm just gonna bring her up on the stage. Ms. Carter Myers Automotive herself, Ms. Liza Myers.
Patriots fans out there? Woo! unfortunately for them to win, the Rams had to lose, right? The Super Bowl. Now, I'm not going to ask if there are any Trump fans out there. I don't want to know. But in order for Donald Trump to win the presidential election, unfortunately, Hillary Clinton apparently had to lose. And I think there's a huge perception, and there has been for a long time in our industry, that either the dealership is winning or the customer is winning, but neither feel like they're both winning. Somebody's given up something. And I'm here to tell you that if you want to win in the auto industry, and if ultimately we all want to win, and we want our model to continue to exist and dealers to be a part of the equation for our customers, we got to figure out how to make this a win-win. Our customers have to be raving fans, as everybody said. They have to be cheering us on, and they want us to be part of their future solution in transportation. So my personal philosophy in life, if I combine it with that of our company, is that it's not how many people we beat, it's how many winners we can create. We've heard the word win thrown around a lot in the last day and a half in many appropriate ways. We are all here to figure out how we're going to win. But I think that word can also hurt our growth if we only think about winning alone. And for a lot of years, I think that's what has created this negative stigma in the car business. We have a negative stigma associated to it, as Glenn would say, for a lot of reasons. One, there's always stories about dealerships taking advantage of customers, getting those six-pounders, and now I will tell you I like gross. As long as it's associated with the value that we have created in order to ask for it, right? Woo! We also have a negative stigma in this industry as a place to have a career. People are always saying, I didn't plan on being in the car business. Sometimes they don't want to admit they sell cars. Hopefully not anybody in this room. But for some reason, we feel the need to apologize for what we do. And I think we also feed the negative stigma by sometimes even bashing our fellow dealers and our industry as a whole. We've got one of our great competitors here in the room, and we are here sharing and collaborating. And ultimately, that's what we're going to have to do in the long run. But today, I'm going to talk to you guys about how important it is for us to create win-wins and how much impact that we can have personally and even more so collectively, and understand how many people's lives we impact, hundreds and thousands and hundreds of thousands of people across this country, if we look at our business through a different lens. If we can focus every day on how we're creating a win-win for our customers, for our associates, and for our communities, we can impact lives, we can create an incredible pride for the industry that I think everybody in this room has, and we can make a difference in this world. So, a little bit about me. I'm Liza Borchus. I'm the president and CEO of Carter Myers Automotive, as Glenn said. But before I got in the car business, or at least before I got in it officially, I got to throw this up there. Tomorrow night, Go Blues Final Four, first time since 1984. I am a very proud UVA alum, and when I graduated from college, I was trying to figure out what to do, and I got to be honest, going into the retail side of the car business was not in my mindset. In fact, it wasn't even discussed in my family. My father was the third generation of our family to run our company. At that time, he had three dealerships. I decided I wanted to stay in the car business, but I took a little different route. And I actually went to work for American Honda Motor Company out in Torrance, California. And I was with them for about 6 years, fantastic company. And after maybe close to the end of my career, I was offered an opportunity to go to a three-day leadership training conference. Not from American Honda, but one of the dealer groups that I called on actually invited me to go to this conference. And so I spent 3 days with their leadership team. It was the Mile One Automotive Group out of Baltimore, Maryland. And so they invited me to spend these 3 days with their team. And we were learning and growing and creating action plans and setting goals. And I left that conference so pumped up, just like you guys are going to leave here tomorrow morning or tonight. And I was driving home in my car to my home office in Annapolis, Maryland. And I realized I just didn't have a platform or a way to implement all of these ideas that I just learned in this conference. And I kind of felt a void. And to be honest, I was just really comfortable in my job. My job was pretty easy. I was out calling on dealers. But I was calling on dealerships that other people owned, and to be honest, they didn't really take a lot of what their district manager says to heart, right? Bill, those are your dealers. They're good people, but I don't know how many great ideas they bring to the table. And so I went home to my husband, and I shared with him how I was feeling, and I said, you know what? I'm ready to be in a dealership. I saw how these teams are going back and making a difference in the lives of their customers and their associates. They've got roots in their community. And I was moving every 2 years around the country. My husband was, he was my fiance at the time. He was super supportive. And we went down to Charlottesville a little bit while later to visit my parents. And my dad told me about a small Volvo dealer that was for sale in Charlottesville, Virginia. Or it wasn't for sale. He said, I think the dealer wants to retire. You should go talk to him. So I called the dealer up right away. We went to a McDonald's in a back booth because he didn't want anybody to see us. He thought that nobody in Charlottesville goes to McDonald's, apparently, at least they knew us. We sat in the back booth, and I put together a letter of intent to buy his dealership on the back of a napkin. We shook hands. 72 hours later, we sold our house in Annapolis, put a contract on the house in Charlottesville, gave notice to our jobs, and moved down to make this happen. So now I'm going to tell you something that I haven't told many people, maybe just my husband. We moved to Charlottesville. I was embarking on a new whole chapter of my life. And I actually was filled with, I was embarrassed and I felt a little bit guilty. And that's going to sound weird. But I hadn't come into the family business right out of college because I was determined to achieve success on my own and not have something given to me. And so now I'm back in Charlottesville. And I got to tell you, I was born lucky. I had two amazing parents. My mom is a saint and an angel, and I just aspire to have half the character that she has. My dad has been a coach and a mentor and has taught me work ethic from the day I was born. And my wonderful sister is here today. She works at a dealership down in Florida. But I got to tell you, we did have challenges. In fact, in the 90s, our family business almost went under. And we had a saying in our family that six cars a day keeps the banker away. And it was that serious. We weren't laughing tonight. But overall, I had a pretty darn good childhood. I was extremely lucky. And now I was being given an opportunity to own and run my own dealership. I did invest my own savings. I bought in 20%. I had to take out a loan to do so, but my family was investing in the rest. So, I've never run a dealership. I've never managed a person. I was 28 years old, and you can't really see it. I looked like I was 15 at best. And here I was standing in front of a group of employees at this Volvo dealership while Mr. Brown was announcing that he was selling me his store. And I was scared to death. I'm looking out at this group of employees. It was a very small dealership, mind you. Every one of them, except for two technicians, was significantly older than me. And I wasn't scared because I lacked the confidence to know that I could do the job. I was scared because they were all staring at me thinking, who is this silly little girl whose dad just gave her a dealership? And now I gotta work for her. So we closed the dealership, or closed the sale, I should say. And I was determined to prove this group of associates wrong. And I kind of came in like a bull in a china shop. I came in, I was there 2 hours before we opened. I was driving the shuttle, I was stocking parts, I was selling every car. I was running around like a madman. And there was all this tension in the air, because that's what you do when you buy a company, right? You feel like you've got to do it all. There was all this tension in the air. And I was not connecting with the team. I was just trying to do their job for them. And I learned really quickly that it did not matter how hard I worked. It didn't matter how hard I worked if the rest of the team, if I was not creating winners around me. If I wasn't bringing them in the loop and sharing with them a vision that they could believe in, where they wanted to help me, and we were doing this together, I was wasting my time, and we were all going to fail together. So we're going to fast forward 15 years. We're going to go real fast. So 15 years forward, the Volvo dealership, I guess about a year after that. Oh, wait, I got to take a step back, because I got to share one last thing. Hold on. While I was at this Volvo dealership, because this was really important, the reason that when I said I got to focus winners around me, I only had a sales staff of two people. They both resigned on the same day, and so I was going to be the only salesperson there the next day on a Saturday, and somebody told me the night before that my whole service team was also about to resign. Both service advisors and the warranty clerk were going to resign the next morning. So I went home, I stayed up all night, I said, what the hell am I going to do? Like, I can do a lot by myself, but I wasn't sure I could do all of that by myself. That's when I said I got to figure out that I needed to figure out winners around me. But my goal was, I came in the next morning, about 5:45 in the morning, and I said to myself, if anybody was willing to stick with me, I was going to make sure that a year from then, they were thanking their lucky stars that I had bought that dealership and joined their team. So now we're going to fast forward. If you move forward about 15 years, we now have grown up a lot. Our biggest growth came right during 2008. And yesterday, Eric was sharing how their company really got crushed in 08 and how much they learned from it. We were a little bit more conservative. And in 2008, there were a lot of dealers out there who decided to throw in the towel, right? They said, this is hard. I got to work harder than I've ever worked. I'm not making as much money. Maybe I'm at the end of my career. I'm going to sell. Well, that was our opportunity to grow. So we went on a buying spree. We bought 7 stores in 7 years, more than doubled the size of our company. We got 2 open points in 2016, and then we took a little hiatus to breathe in 2017 and 2018, get our open points profitable, up and running. I have to say, everybody in this room will keep this super confidential, right? Nobody's on Facebook Live. We will be announcing soon a couple more dealerships to add to the CMA group very soon in 2019. Markets and we have 600 associates, and I still wake up every single day knowing that my purpose is to create as many winners personally and in our company as I can. Woo! You guys are giving me so much love. I often think every morning, how can I wake up and make sure that everybody else around me is waking up feeling as lucky as I do in life? We, our industry, and all of us in this room, we have an opportunity to impact more lives than I think we give ourselves credit for. Collectively, we touch millions of families. We sold 17 million new cars last year, right? Those are families that we touched. Over 12 million used cars as new car franchise dealers. And if you count the customers we touched in service, you multiply all those together, it's somewhere in the billions, right? Billions of service customers that we touch every single day. And if we can focus and change the lens of how we look on our industry to say, how do we create win-wins every day for our customers, for our associates, for our communities, that's how we're gonna change this industry. So that's what I'm going to talk about for the next 10 minutes, I think. People always talk about the biggest purchase in someone's life. What is it? I don't agree. I think it's a car. I think that the car is the most important purchase in their lives. Yes, Tabitha, you're right up there, and I think Josh is. The car is the most important purchase in someone's life because if they don't have a car, they can't get to work to pay the bills that bought that house and put food on the table. They don't have a car, they may not get to their kid to the doctor's office, to the soccer tournament, to a tutor. Cars give us freedom to go where we need to go. Whether you want to visit your family a lot or a little, your car is probably going to get you there. If you want to go to a wedding out of state, visit an ailing father, maybe a nurse, one of your niece's dance recital across town, that's what's going to get you there, it's your vehicle. But cars also deliver a lot of joy in life. That's how we have date nights and movies and go to shopping and go to church. Our job is not to help a customer buy or service their vehicle. Our mission is to help customers where they want to go in life. We interact with lots of different customers every single day. So tomorrow, Tabitha might meet a customer who just wants a high-performance vehicle because they love the rush and the feel of taking that car down the highway, right? And then the next day, Josh might have a customer who has a growing family. They got twins on the way, but we could only approve them for $390 a month, and he's got to solve that problem and figure out how to find a vehicle to put them in. And then the next day, Naomi's going to meet a customer in our service department who just needs us to do just enough on their car to fix it so they can reliably get to their job every single day and make sure they don't get fired. We got to change our culture to think not about how many cars we get over the curb. We got to figure out how many customers we can find transportation solutions for. And if we do that, those repeats, those referrals, they're going to exponentially hit our goals. We're going to hit the sales numbers that our manufacturers require we hit. And it's going to be a win-win for our customers and for our associates, right? We've got to shift our thinking from how do we hit a high-gross deal to how we create a high-value deal. We can't focus on how many products that we can cram into one finance deal, right? When we ask the right questions, we sell the right products. Quick example. Is it truly a win-win if we have a finance manager sitting in the office at $1,600 PVR, but they're selling the same 3 products to every customer that walks in their office? What about the family that walks in and they didn't ask to say, what are you doing in life? We just moved in a new house. We're in a new neighborhood with all this new construction. Probably going to get 3 nails in our tires the first 6 months of ownership. Tire on wheel would probably be a great product for them. create value for the customer, create PVR for us. The next family that walks in the finance office, they didn't share that they've got their two teenage sons that are also going to be driving this car. And those same two teenage sons have lost 3 sets of keys in the last year. Key replacement would probably be a great thing for us to offer them, value to them, gross for us. We can get gross. We can get more gross if we ask the right questions and find the right solutions for our customers. If we create that win-win, it's going to help the customer, it's going to help our bottom line. Let me ask you a question about service. What if we thought about service as, instead of how many hours per repair order we sold, what if we looked at it as how many problems we solved per repair order for that customer? It's a win-win. It's an easy sell. We got to be looking at how many customers we win, that we create wins for this month, and not how many of them we sell a car to. The second way we've got to create a win-win is for our associates. I think the auto industry, if I have this number right, I think we employ over 2 million people just in new car franchise dealerships across this country, and their families also rely on us. I said earlier, a lot of you guys didn't need to be in the car business. Many don't even want to admit that they sell cars. But our sales associates and service advisors impact more lives, not only than anyone in our dealerships, but they impact more lives than almost any other industry. This is a serious job. There are so many ways that we can create win-wins for our customers and for our associates, but the majority of people don't seek out the auto industry as a place to have a career. Our managers, our general managers, our owners, we gotta find ways to address this now. Unemployment is as low as it's been in a long time, and we gotta change the message and we gotta tell our story. So I'm gonna tell you guys just a little bit about our story and expand upon what Glenn shared with you. Now, this might not be something that's gonna work in every dealership, but I hope that what I'm gonna share with you inspires you to figure out what is your win-win for your associates. It might spark something. So when I joined CMA, we already had a strong foundation of creating win-wins for our associates. We've been an ESOP company for 40 years. As Glenn mentioned, we share ownership with our associates. In fact, our team and everybody here, they own 26% of our company. The more success that we have, the more contribution we put in. We typically put in 10% of our profits into the ESOP each year. The more stock they get to buy, the better we perform, the better our bottom line, the more our stock price rises. So you can see on this chart, 2003, that's how our stock price has done since 2003. That's 2008. More than 50% of our top 50 stockholders are not in management and never have been in management. But they've stuck with us over the years, they've been loyal to the company, they've performed and they've contributed significantly. And I gotta highlight just a couple. So this guy, Carl Solo, started with us when he was 17 years old as a technician. He is now the fourth largest stockholder in our company. Beth Layla. She's never been in management. She's been with us 42 years. She has been booking deals, doing title work in our accounting office, and she is the eighth largest stockholder in our company. And Simona Holloway has been finding transportation solutions on our sales floor for 33 years, and she is the 12th largest stockholder in our company. Too many people today, and I think even a lot of people in this room, live paycheck to paycheck and don't have a plan for retirement. Our mission as a company and for our 600 associates is to try to help in 4 ways. First, to create career paths and growth opportunities. It's one of the reasons that it pushes me to buy more dealerships. I want to make sure we're giving opportunities to our team. We want them to find pride and purpose in understanding how important their job is and realize how much we matter. You all matter. We want to create financial stability and future retirement plans for our team. The more profitable our company is, the better each person gives and takes care of our customers, the more money we make, the more money we contribute to the ESOP, the more that they're going to have in their retirement. Now, I'm proud to say in 2017, we actually contributed 28% of our profits to the ESOP. It was over $4,000 a stock for the average employee. That doesn't include when the price goes up this year, because we just had a record year in 2018. People and their futures, we are going to win collectively better than we could ever win alone. Yeah. I was talking to another dealer. this morning about general managers. And so one thing we do in our company, and I know some others out there do, but we offer our general managers the ability to buy into the dealerships that they run. We want them to be full partners with us in it together. It would be easy, again, to keep that ownership within the family, but we got a lot of people out there who have dreams of being a car dealer, of owning their own dealership, and that's something else that we're looking to fulfill. We've got 7 partners right now, not including the 500 in our ESOP. And hopefully, and actually I know, each of these general managers is creating a better future for their families and fulfilling dreams that we hope together we are creating. And I gotta tell you, general managers are an incredibly important part of our industry. They are important leaders. And as dealerships are consolidating and becoming part of much larger dealer groups, obviously no longer are we gonna have a single dealer or owner in each store. And sharing ownership and this responsibility is what's going to create a great future for our industry. There's simply no room for greed. If we truly want to recruit and retain top-level leaders and entrepreneurs, as we continue to consolidate as an industry, we got to change the model. I will say psychology tells us that when you own something, you take better care of it, right? So hopefully all of our employees, with 26% of the company they own, they're going to take really good care of it. I know our general managers, with the investment in their stores, are taking really good care of it. One other quick topic I want to touch on, and some of you may agree, or some of you may tell me I need to get off the stage with this one, but I'm going to talk about our pay plans for a moment. Margin compression is real, and it's only getting tougher. And when I mentioned that we've got to create financial, people have been leaving our industry because of what happens with pay plans in our dealerships. They've got to be created as a win-win, and unlike other industries, we have these horribly complex, constantly changing pay plans that create instability and insecurity for our teams. Someone makes too much money, or we don't hit our goal, let's change the pay plan. Happens way too often. If we have the right pay plans, we should be celebrating when our associates have a record paycheck. It is a win-win. We want to have the highest paid sales associates in the industry at CMA. I know if they're making a ton of money, the manager's making money, the GM's making money, the company's making money, I'm making money, and our stock price is going up. So it is a serious job, which is another reason they need to make good money. If we have the right people and the right pay plans, and we've got mutual goals that we have set together, we're going to win together. For our sales associates and our service advisors in the room, you got to take your job and the impact that you make on lives super seriously. But as importantly, we need you to share your story. We need you to help find others that want to have success in our industry. We can't do it alone. We don't have enough people in this room to be able to do this alone. And we've got to be able to bring new people to our industry who want a career in automotive. And you guys are our best recruiters. I'm going to show you guys a quick video, thanks to Carlton Melton. Where's Carlton? He's somewhere in this room. But he's been doing videos of a lot of our associates, helping them share stories. And this one's actually just a draft, so Carlton, I apologize, it's not done, but I really like the message. So watch this for a moment. Oh no, no sound. Well, we'll move on. this video was about she's now a sales manager, Kim Garner, and she started with us 10 years ago as a salesperson. And she goes about the story, and I'm actually going to email and share it out with you because it's awesome about how to recruit women in particular onto our showroom floors. And at the end, she's so authentic, like this was not scripted. She just started talking, and she started talking about how great of an industry it was and how great to have women because there's another perspective on the sales floor that we're missing because we don't diversify enough, we don't reflect our customer base. And at the end, she just spontaneously says, please come join us. We've got all kinds of these videos going on that we're going to start deploying on social media, and we need everybody in this room. We got to tell the story, and we got to share the message, and we've got to recruit better people who are like-minded, like all of us in this room. Let's see if I can pass this video. Okay, I'm going to move on to my last topic because I'm running out of time. But that is, how do we create win-wins in our communities? Everybody in this room gives back a ton. All these pictures, you guys all have them. Car dealers sponsor and are more involved in our communities than probably any other industry. Banking might be the only one that rivals us. You see banks' names on every banner, I think, in town. But I challenged myself a year ago to really think through how we were giving back, because we sponsor a little league team, and we give to this particular walk, and we sponsor someone at the Boys and Girls Cup. There's money going everywhere. But I thought if we could do it more intentionally and understand how we as an industry could do it better, what would that look like? As we all know, there are people struggling. There are people that are struggling in this world, not self-sufficient. They're living below the poverty line. They're underemployed or they're underemployed. We did a study in Charlottesville, and we looked at every family in Charlottesville who was considered not to be self-sufficient. And that meant that they weren't living on government subsidies, that they were able to make it on their own without additional community support. And we found two things that were reasons why families aren't making it. And this is apparently the norm nationally. If in order to hold down a job, they gotta have affordable and reliable childcare, and they have to have affordable and reliable transportation. Those were the two main factors that stopped families from being self-sufficient. And so we've had all these car dealers who give back a ton. How could we take the transportation piece and truly make a dent on the poverty cycle in our country? So I started collaborating with five different nonprofits who all had families that were kind of right on the bubble. They just needed that extra leg up of something, whether it be childcare or transportation, some of them it was other things, just to become self-sufficient. And we're planning on starting a nonprofit later this year. And what we're going to be looking at is how do we donate? We've got all the facilities, the technicians' time, the parts, we've got banks. We've got a partner right now in this collaborative that's a local bank. Because we found that there's two reasons people don't have affordable, reliable transportation. Either they have a car and it needs so much in repair they can't afford to do it, or their credit is so damaged they can't get a loan, right? We see that all the time. They walk in our service departments, they walk in our showrooms, and we can't help them. But there are nonprofits that can find the people who have the best intent, they've got the job, they've got the other pieces in place, but they need our help. So we're gonna model this in Charlottesville and work on it, and I hope to be able to share this out, whether it be through this group and other groups, and figure out how as an industry we can be more intentional with our giving, really take transportation, because if we use the skills we already have, we can make four times the difference that we are right now. That would be unbelievable in our country. We're gonna help these families move forward in their life, and we're gonna create a model that hopefully we can take across the country. If we can create win-win solutions for our customers, win-win futures for our associates, and win-win contributions to our communities, that's how we're gonna get rid of the negative stigma around the car business and actually make a huge lasting impact in this world. At Carter Myers Automotive, our mission and our vision is that we are owners who just do more, and we do it why? We do it because we wanna move lives forward. And it would be really easy for us to just keep this message to ourselves, make it be just about our company. This is why we're unique, this is why we're special. But it's not about us just beating other dealership groups. It's all about how many can we get to join us. What we do matters. Our industry is important to our customers' lives. It's important to the economy of our country. And it's important to the future of the 2 million people that work with us and their families who count on us. And we need to all walk out of here with pride. We gotta take our responsibility for our customers and for our associates, for our communities, really seriously. So let me close by asking, how many winners are we gonna create together? Yeah. Thank you, guys.